wonder when and how the Himalayas or the Rocky Mountains formed? Well, in this video, I'm going to be talking about tectonics and geologic events that occurred during the Neogene period in Earth's history, which includes the formation of the Himalayas, the Rockies, and other major geological formations. The Neogene is a period within the Cenozoic area that went from around 23 to 2.6 million years ago. It includes the Miocene and Pliocene epochs, and in terms of geologic events, the Rocky Mountains formed, the Basin and Range Province of Western North America formed, the Yellowstone Hot Spot was formed and migrated to its current position, and the mountains of the west coast of North America formed, like the Cascades, Sierra Nevada, the Transverse and Peninsular ranges, and other coastal ranges. The San Andreas Fault formed, the glaciation of Northern America caused a lot of glacial landscapes throughout that region, the Panamanian land bridge formed and connected North and South America, allowing migration of many animals between the two continents, the Himalayas formed, and the Tethys Seaway closed. So starting with North America, specifically the western region of North America, after the third stage of Cordilleran mountain building, or the Laramide orogeny, which was a mountain building event due to subduction under the western margin of North America from the Cretaceous to the Eocene periods, or late Mesozoic to early Cenozoic, after the uplifts caused by that orogenic event were leveled by erosion, there was a blank slate ready for Neogene uplift. And during this time, the Rockies, the Basin and Range Province, and coastal ranges uplifted and formed by tectonic and igneous activity in the Neogene. The Farallon Plate, the plate that subducted under the western margin of North America during the Mesozoic and into the early Cenozoic, had largely been subducted and was completely gone underneath the North American Plate, but the remnants of the Farallon Plate still existed to the north and south as the Juan de Fuca Plate and the Couscous Plate, and the plate coming in behind it was the Pacific Plate, which continues to subduct under North America today. The subduction to the northwestern region of the U.S. formed the igneous arc that we now call the Cascade Range that is still volcanically active today. We can see a little bit of the southern part of the Cascades in this California map here, but it is mostly north of that in Oregon and Washington. And if we look at the figure to the bottom left, we can see how the subduction causes the melting that causes the igneous activity that leads to igneous arcs that form, in this case, the Cascade Range. Further south, however, within California mostly, Miocene faulting and mountain building raised parts of the coastal ranges and other nearby mountain ranges. However, the granitic plutons of Sierra Nevada were already emplaced by the Mesozoic, which was the era before the Cenozoic era even started, so long before the Neogene. However, their uplift and deformation continued into the Neogene. We can see in the figure in the center, 40 million years ago, there was continued subduction and igneous activity at that western margin, and that continued to fuel the uplift and activity of Sierra Nevada. However, around 30 to 20 million years ago in the transition from Paleogene to Neogene, the nature of subduction under the North American plate had changed enough to at least slow the igneous activity occurring in Sierra Nevada, and instead the uplift and deformation continued without all the igneous activity, and then later on extension even occurred east of the Sierra Nevadas in what's called the Basin and Range Province, which we'll get to in a little bit, and then east of that is the Rockies, and then west of the Sierra Nevadas is the coastal ranges, which actually includes a lot of land that wasn't even there connected to the continental mass during, you know, the early stages of this subduction under North America. This is accreted land from the Pacific Plate as it subducted under the North American Plate rather than land from the North American Plate itself. In between Sierra Nevada and the coastal ranges is a great valley that we call the Great Valley. And during Sierra Nevada uplift, sediments shed into the Great Valley. We can see in the figure to the right that during the Miocene, the Great Valley was connected to the ocean and contained marine waters. However, the Pliocene and Pleistocene epochs after the Miocene brought more uplift along the San Andreas Fault, which I abbreviated here SAF, that cut connection between the ocean and the Great Valley, making it a terrestrial basin instead of a marine one. So let's talk about this San Andreas Fault, shall we? Well, many faults were formed in the coastal ranges during uplift and deformation as these plates pushed against each other and the Pacific plates ducted and accreted and whatever against the North American plate. And the longest of these faults is the San Andreas Fault, which stretches for 1,600 kilometers or 1,000 miles. As a Texan who drives across Texas to get home occasionally, I know how long 1,000 miles is, and it's no fun. It's very long. So that's a pretty long distance for a fault. And it started or formed and began slipping in the Miocene, and since then, or in the past 15 million years actually, has moved or slipped 315 kilometers or 190 miles along its boundary. And this isn't a fault that's, you know, a normal fault or a reverse fault that is moving up or down. It's a fault where it's moving side to side. So it's called a transform fault or a strike slip fault. And it actually connects the Juan de Fuca spreading center with all the way to the south, the Sea of Cortez spreading center. So these are very far apart from each other, but it connects the two with its, you know, fault boundary. And it forms the boundary between the North American and Pacific plates, as we saw in that previous figure there. And as you can see, it kind of is in front of and then cuts through the coastal ranges, indicating that part of the coastal ranges aren't even part of the North American plate. They're part of the Pacific plate. And there is absolutely no evidence that says this fault is anywhere done with slipping or moving. So it still marks a very real threat today. So what about east of Sierra Nevada, where we have the big Basin and Range Province, which looks small on this figure just of how it's scaled, but if we look over here to the figure on the right, we can see how large this province of Basin and Range topography really is, and it is quite a lot of the U.S. and Mexico. And if you're unsure what Basin and Range means, it's just topography covered in gravens or fault-blocked basins and ranges. So what might you ask caused extension in this world of plates pushing against each other? Well, thinning of the lithosphere caused by mantle upwelling began this extensional regime in this large area between two major uplifting areas, Sierra Nevada and the Rocky Mountains. And in this region of extensional forces and basin and range topography is where the Yellowstone Hotspot was born. The thinned crust permitted a plume to force magma up through the crust. And this began what's called a hotspot underneath part of the U.S., which has migrated over time. Well, the hotspot hasn't migrated because the mantle is not migrating, but the lithosphere is migrating because, again, it's plates. And so the lithospheric plate is migrating over the hotspot, causing the activity caused by the hotspot to seem like it's migrating over the land when really the land is migrating over it. But anyway, the magma was forced up through it, and that was the birth of the Yellowstone hotspot. Now, this you can see is a figure of a hotspot underneath oceanic crust in the middle of the ocean, but they can occur under continents as well. And that's what we have in the U.S. as the Yellowstone hotspot. The northeast migration of the hotspot was due to the southwest movement of the North American plate around 22 kilometers per million years. And eventually the hotspot reached its present day Yellowstone location. And on its migration pathway, this hotspot caused a lot of volcanism, which is why we can track its migration pattern pretty easily. Early on, it caused the formation of the Columbia River Basalt and Snake River Plain, as those volcanic rocks erupted from fissures produced by the migrating hotspot. The lava flows that make up the Columbia River Basalt blanketed large areas of Oregon, Washington, and Idaho. I mean, look at how huge this was. And some of it even flowed all the way to the Pacific Ocean, as we can see by this path here, all the way to the Pacific Ocean. That's 500 kilometers or 300 miles of lava flowing over land. That's pretty terrifying. However, in terms of this hotspot today, the most recent eruption due to this hotspot was around 70,000 years ago. And today, the hotspot only really manifests itself at the surface as hot springs and geysers that attract visitors to the Yellowstone National Park. But nevertheless, it still represents a threat and could cause volcanic activity in the future that's a little bit more dangerous than hot springs and geysers. Another major thing going on during this time was the glaciation of the Northern Hemisphere. So I talk in my Neogene climate video more about this and how it affected biology and how it affected the environments and all of that, but I'll talk here about how it affected geologic features. portions of the Rocky Mountains and Sierra Nevada were carved into U-shaped valleys, smooth valleys that are shaped like a U, by glaciers, because rivers carve valleys that are V-shaped. And these U-shaped valleys moved further southward and expanded during glacial maxima. And because of the carving of glaciers throughout glacial maxima and minima through the interglacial cycles that mark the modern ice age, we can see how far glaciers have extended in those maximum time periods. Another thing that we can see and track throughout these glacial periods is the flooding of Lake Missoula. Lake Missoula was an ancient glacial lake that was dammed by ice that broke and reformed periodically, causing estimated about 40 catastrophic episodic floods. These floods would scour the landscape and form sequential rippled gravel deposits, which we can now track them by. We can see the path of the floods in the figure to the bottom left, and just how large an area these floods from this one lake affected. In fact, these floods, these 40 catastrophic floods from this one lake, were the largest ever identified on Earth or throughout Earth's history. And interestingly, the guy that first proposed that this happened was laughed at and called crazy, because they were like, no way that happened, but it did. And we have all this rock evidence now, and it's undeniable now, but it largest in Earth's history, and people laughed at him. I mean, that's crazy. Another major geological event, though, was the formation of the Panamanian land bridge, or the connection between North and South America. This occurred during the Pliocene, around 3.5 million years ago, and this allowed the migration of mammals between these two continental masses, in which camel, pig, deer, horse, elephant, tapir, rhino, rat, skunk, squirrel, rabbit, bear, dog, raccoon, and cat families made it to South America from North America, and monkeys, anteaters, armadillos, porcupines, and possums spread to North America. However, as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, one of the major things that occurred during this time, or largely during this time, was the formation and uplift of the modern day tallest mountain range on Earth, which is the Himalayan mountain range. And this was because the Indian Peninsula moved northward after Gondwana, a large supercontinent in Earth's past, broke up and allowed the Indian Peninsula to move north. And it did so for millions of years throughout the Mesozoic to the Neogene before it finally reached the Eurasian plate. When it collided with Eurasia in continent-to-continent convergence, that began the formation of today's tallest mountain range. Pre-Neogene, before it collided with Eurasia, shallow seas covered much of India, forming limestone deposits. And we can tell when it switched drastically, because those Eocene limestone deposits from pre-collision India were overlain by Miocene alluvial deposits from the uplift of the mountains and obviously erosion off those mountains. And this occurred around 20 million years ago, and much of the uplift has occurred within the past 15 million years. Pre-continent-continent collision, there was ocean-continent convergence of the oceanic part of the plate that India was part of. And this oceanic crust in front of, or north of India, as it moved north toward the Eurasian plate, was subducted under the Eurasian plate, because oceanic crust is dense and can subduct. But when the Indian Craton reached the subduction zone, it was too buoyant to subduct. Continental crusts won't subduct. So it caused deformation and uplift, the only thing it could do, and the Himalayas were born. These plates are currently still pushing against each other and don't plan on stopping anytime soon. And because of this, mountain building in this region isn't over. However, one thing that's over because of this collision is the Tethys Seaway. Collision of Africa with Eurasia, which occurred before India, and then India with Eurasia a little bit later, caused the closing of the Tethys Sea, which was a major sea during much of the Mesozoic after Pangaea formed at the end of the Paleozoic, and then it began closing because Africa came up and closed that part of the Tethys Sea, and then India came up and closed the rest, and now the only remnants left of the Tethys Seaway today are the Mediterranean, Black, Caspian, and Aral Seas. That is all I have for today's video. If you want to check out my major reference, it is linked in my description below, called Earth System History. I also have minor and supporting references down there. And if you want to check out the related videos to this one, other Neogene period events that occurred, like human evolution or other life events that occurred, or climate events that occurred, you can check out those videos that are up here. If I have them out by now, I'll try and put them on the screen for you. And if you want to check out any other type of event that occurred throughout Earth's history, you can check out my historical geology playlist, which will show up at the bottom of the screen here any minute now. And with that, guys, I thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you next time. Bye.